I'm gonna tell a few words about the time machine I've been working on for XML. And at the end, so this was presented at XML Prague, so I just give that as a reminder. I think most of you were there. And then I give you a demo of some web interface that shows the time machine and also some measurements. So the first... The first motivation for doing a time machine is that you, with so much hard disk place available, you do not need to update in place. You can create a new version every time you update your data. This is something that is very useful. So for a long time, there have been cold versioning systems like Bazaar, which is one of them. Apple is in its last operating system is actually introducing versions, which just does that with your documents. Another motivation is collaborative work. There's a lot in the last few years. There's been a lot of development about Office applications as web applications in your browser. The question that we started with was, what about semi-structured data? How does that fit into all that? Because on the one side, you have documents like source code on SVN or on CVS. And on the other hand, you have data, which fits into temporal databases, for example, like relational tables. And in the middle, you have XML, and we kind of wanted to bridge the gap of versioning between data and documents. Mostly how it is organized, the architecture is that you have a sequence of trees, the versions of a tree, and you do queries and updates against it. You have queries that do the dev task, and we use XQuery core update and scripting. So if I go just a tiny bit more into the details, this is a tree timeline. This is just the terminology that we use. So these are three versions of the tree that are in the repository. They can no longer be changed. And this is the local version that has been checked out that can be checked back in. Then this is a node timeline, so there's nothing new here. So we call timeline everything that spans over time. These are the versions, 1, 2, and 3, and local. And we identify a node item by just saying, giving a version URI actually, and a timeline URI, and that uniquely identifies a version. There's interesting problems that arose here. For example, what's the identity of a node? Because like if you travel back in time and meet yourself, it's you, but it's not you. So there's kind of two ways of defining identity. So this is the kind of interesting challenges that we had to face in defining this. I said that we have pending update lists as deltas. So this is an example. So instead, you know, in SVN or CVS, the delta is given as a diff, meaning I inserted that line, I deleted that line. And here it seems to be quite natural to reuse the pending update list from the XQuery update specification to do just that. Another thing that we extended is the axis. So there are space axes that are already here in XML, and basically we just did the same for the time to navigate in time, so you can navigate like in space and in time within a program. This was an example that shows that, for example, if you have a single node in several versions in time that give the temperature, then from this you can take all of the future nodes, and from this one you take all of the past nodes and you do the intersection and then compute the average to get the average temperature. The processing model is that you can have several clients. They all checked out some node and have a local pending update list with their local changes, and what happens here is isolated and atomic. There cannot be two clients trying to communicate with the repository at the same time. And basically what happens regarding atomicity concurrent access to the repository, it's all done at the policy level, meaning each application can say whether it wants to see updates from other people or not, whether you do not want to see them at all. This is all configurable and each application can say that. For the implementation, there was a basic idea. That is that if you look at, for example, the three versions of this tree, you know that in XQuery update, you cannot move nodes around. You can only insert or delete nodes. And actually, this gave us an advantage. It is that the parent of a node never changes over time. It means that all of the timelines here, there are six of them, they can be organized in a tree. Like this. Meaning that the implementation of all these sequence of trees can actually be done with a single tree. The user doesn't see that. This is only the implementation of the XQuery engine that supports versioning. So this is how it would be done in memory to avoid redundancy. Another thing that I said is that deltas are used as PULs, but actually if you use scripting, it could be that you have several pending update lists that are applied in turn and you need to kind of merge them. Federico said a few words about that. So I just wanted to say one thing is that what's interesting, I don't use quite the same name, as I call that composition. And what's interesting is that there are two ways of composing update primitives. And the first one I call aggregation. It's when the target of an update here is actually the content of another pending update list. This is what I call aggregation. And so you can aggregate, meaning put the content in the first below the its target in the pending update list here. The second thing that can happen is that the target is not in the other pending update list that was already here, so then you kind of accumulate them more than you aggregate them. So this is these are the two cases. So now I'm going to show the quick demo. So it's implemented on top of Sausalito, and it runs in the cloud, and I have a benchmark about that. So if I shortly show to you the demo, of course there will be the demo effect, so it will certainly crash, but I'm trying anyway. So for example, I can insert a node, so it's empty at the beginning. Okay. Yeah, it worked. This is the local version that was checked out, and this is the repository here. At the beginning, it was empty, so you see the version URI, you see the number of the version here. Version 1 is empty, and version 2 contains this node here. Then I can also add another node at the end, so it was added here. But instead of updating in place, it creates logically a second version here on the logical level. And then, of course, you can also add some node here as a child, for example, here, and it creates yet another version that you see below. And I implemented several aspects of the update primitives that you can have. So this shows a little bit how it works. If you're interested, I can also show a little bit some indexing. So actually, I index on A/attribute B. So if I put this node into the collection, it's actually going to be indexed. And I probe here the index on the value foo. So it doesn't appear here. But if I modify the value here, and I say now this is foo, then it should appear in the probed index. So it means that I'm indexing the latest version. So it's compatible with indices. You can even imagine to build indices in past versions so that you can even navigate over time more quickly. And the last thing that is interesting, I can show you how some measurements look like if I did. So this is the comparison of the time travel and no time travel. So you see that this is a typical query. So what happens here is that over time, I launch 100,000 queries, and I pick them randomly from a set of predefined queries. This is called this is the TFOX benchmark, if you are familiar. And what happens is that it reaches a steady state. So the red is normal because the size of the connection is always the same. There's as many inserts as deletes. But what's interesting is that the time machine as well here. So this is using indices, so this was something you would expect. And I have some more examples here. So without indices, it's a little bit less good, but I think that it's still improvable using a different serialization format, which I'm working on. And here it's time travel, meaning I'm traveling back in time, but again, without indices, and there's some improvements that can be done here as well. With indices, it can be even faster. And if you look at the updates, this is also kind of steady. This is also because of the serialization issue. But here you see that it's a steady state as well over time. The performance does not degrade. So this is actually what I wanted to show to you. Oh no, this is. Thank you.